Class 7, today we are going to read the poem A Night with a Wolf. Okay, page number 19 in your Moonbeam textbook. The author of the poem is Bayard Taylor, who lived in the period of 1825 to 1878. He was born in Pennsylvania, USA. He began writing poem at a young age. He traveled a lot, and his writing about his travels are quite well known. Okay, you might have heard about Pennsylvania in USA. Is known as the Keystone State for its role in building the foundations of the United States of America. It is here that the Declaration of Independence, U.S. Constitution, and the Gettysburg Address were written. Bayard Taylor began writing poem at a young age. He traveled a lot because he was found with traveling, and his experiences in his travels, which he has written, are quite well known. So he was fond of traveling. He was a good traveler. How many of you are having the interest of travel and discover new places? Hodophile, noun, its plural is hodophiles. Hodophile. Is the word for one who loves to travel. There are lot of synonyms found in English language for travel lovers. You might have heard about globetrotter. Globetrotter is who loves to hop between countries. Itinerant, I-T-I-N-E-R-A-N-T. Itinerant is one who leave to travel. One who leave to travel is known as itinerant. Roadie, R-O-A-D-I-E, Roadi. It is biking groups, also called Roadi, but earlier period Roadis accompany bands or musicians and travel in a group. Then another word for travel lovers, rover, R-O-V-E-R. Roving around for a change. Become a rover is a travel lover. Wayfarer, wayfarer, W-A-Y-F-A-R-E-R, wayfarer. Catch flight, not feeling, is what the quote says. All travel lovers are wayfarers in a way. www.artoftravel.store explain more about it. Another word for travel lovers is vagabond, V-A-G-A-B-O-N-D. People who make any place their home. are in reality the vagabonds, the daring nomads, adventurers, and travelers. You might have heard this quote from Saint Augustine of Hippo: "The world is a book, and those who do not travel read only one page." The world is a book. Those who do not travel read only one page. Another word for travel lovers is solivagant. SOLIVAGANT. Solivagant, soliavagant. When you are brave enough to take on the road yourself, you became a solivagant. Another word used for travel lovers is travel buff. TRAVELBUFF. Travel buff. You might have heard wisdom comes from experience, and those who are travelers achieve knowledge through traveling. That is what make them the travel buffs. Next, hodophile. You have already come across that word. Hodophile, the very word for travel lovers. Then grey nod, GREY NOMAD, grey nomad. A retired old man traveling in a motor home or a caravan is named as a grey nomad. www.artotravel.store give you detailed description about travel lovers. If you want, you can visit there. A night with a wolf. The summary of the poem is, in the poem A Night with a Wolf, written by Bayard Taylor, the poet tells a story to a child and in return asks affection from him. The poet called the child to sit on his lap and listen to one of the stories. He asked the child to give him a kiss after listening to the story. Below the heading of the poem, you can see certain expressions have given. What does each of these expression means that you have to tell? Try. A, to cry wolf. This expression means to raise a false alarm. To raise a false alarm. B, to keep the wolf from the door. To ward off poverty and hunger. To eradicate poverty or hunger. That is the meaning of this expression. To keep the wolf from the door means. C, to wolf something down. This expression means to eat voraciously is an adjective. Voracious used to describe a wolf like appetite, meaning consuming large quantities of food. Eating large quantities of food is the expression means, to wolf something down. Next one, D, to be a wolf in sheep clothing. This expression means an enemy disguised as a friend. Disguised means concealed or obscured, made unrecognizable. If you wear a mask, even your familiar people cannot easily recognize you. That is the word meaning disguised. Okay. Then the next sentence, What do you read there? Do you know of any story in which a wolf is not the villain? Can you say any of the story in which a wolf is not the villain? You might have heard about the three little pigs. Is it not? The three little pigs. The story goes like this. The three little pigs is a fable about three pigs who build three houses of different materials. A big bad wolf blows down the first two pig houses, made of straw and sticks respectively, but is unable to destroy the third pig's house made of bricks. This is the story of the three little pigs. The three little pigs is a children's pictures book written and illustrated by David Weisner. Weisner won the 2002 Caldecott Medal for his illustrations. Weisner's second of three such medals. About the book, The Three Pigs, author David Weisner, illustrator David Weisner, country United States, genre children's pictures book, publisher Carrion Horton Michelin, publication date 2001, pages 40. You can get the story book even through Amazon itself in online. Okay, let me read this poem for you. Little one, come to my knee, hark how the rain is pouring. Over the roof in the pitch dark night, and the wind in the woods a roaring. Hush, my darling, and listen, then pay for the story with kisses. Father was lost in the pitch black night, in which such a storm as this is. High on the lonely mountain, where the wild men watched and waited, wolf in the forest and bears in the bush, and I on my path belated. Belated means delayed, delay, late, honor. The rain and the night together came down, and the wind came after, bending the props of the pine tree roof and snapping many a rafter. Rafter here means high branches of trees. Rafter. I crept alone in the darkness, stunned and bruised and blinded, crept to a fir with a thick set boughs. Boughs. Boughs indicate large branches of tree. Rafter is a high branches of tree. Bough is a large branches of trees and a sheltering rock behind it. I crept alone in the darkness, stunned and bruised and blinded, crept on a fir with a thick set boughs and a sheltering rock behind it. There from the blowing and raining, crouching I saw to hide me. Something rustled, two green eyes shone, and a wolf lay down beside me. Little one, be not frightened, and I and the wolf together, side by side through the long, long night, hide from the awful weather. Awful, fearful, wonderful. His wet fur pressed against me, Each of us warmed the other. Each of us felt in the stormy dark that beast and man was brother. And when the falling forest no longer crushed in warning, each of us went from our hiding place forth in the wild wet morning. Darling, kiss me in payment. Hark, how the wind is roaring. Father's house is a better place when the stormy rain is pouring. In the first stanza and the last stanza of the poem, you can see the use of personification. First stanza, last sentence, and the wind in the woods a roaring. Really, do wind roar? Have you heard the roaring of wind? The same expression you can read in the last stanza of the poem also. See, in the second stanza, second line of the last stanza, hark how the wind is roaring. You might have heard about the roaring of a lion, because lion roar, wind won't roar, wind is only flowing, is it not? It is a literary technique called personification, the poet used in the poem. What is personification? Personification is a literary technique attributing human qualities on non-living things. Okay, personification is a literary technique attributing human qualities on non-living things, as the wind is roaring. Okay, I hope you might have seen wolf, at least in Animal Planet or Discovery Channel or National Geography. Okay, wolf, a wild carnivorous animal, carnivorous mammal, which is the largest member of the dog family. Wolf is a wild carnivorous mammal. It belongs to the dog family. You might have seen it. It has a similarity with the dog because it belongs to dog family. The theme of the poem is adventure and animal. What is adventure? An unusual and exciting or daring experience. An unusual and exciting or daring experience is known as adventure. Example, a skydiver is an example of an adventurous person. The topic of the poem is hostility or friendship. Topic should suggest what the poem is about. Here the subject is the hostility or friendship. Then tune is the attitude of the poet toward his subject. Mood is the feeling expressed in the poem. How does a writer create a mood? Certain expressions in the poem reveal the mood of the poet. Pitch black night. Black denotes darkness and desperation. Two green eyes shone. Green denotes envy. Lonely mountain, wild men, awful weather. Long, long night. falling forest, hiding place, better place are expressions reveal the mood of the poet. Okay, have you heard about genre? Genre, what literary genre means? Listen carefully. What literary genre means? Genre means a type of art, literature or music characterized by a specific form, content and style. Okay, for example, literature has four main genres: poetry, drama, fiction and non-fiction. How many genres are there in English literature? There are four genres in English literature. The four main genres in English literature are poetry, drama, fiction and non-fiction. All of these genres have particular features and function that distinguish them from one another. Okay. Rhyme scheme meaning. What is rhyme scheme meaning? Can you say the ordered pattern of rhymes at the ends of the lines of a poem or verse is rhyme scheme. The ordered pattern of rhymes at the end of the line of a poem or verse. What is rhyme scheme of the poem? Can you say? Rhyme scheme is the pattern of rhyme that comes at the end of each verse or line in poetry. In other words, it is the structure of end words of a verse or line that a poet need to create when writing a poem. Many poems are written in free verse style. Okay, some of the main type of rhymes. First one is end rhymes, rhyming of the final word of lines in a poem, end rhymes. Second, internal rhymes, rhyming of two words within the same line of poetry. It is called internal rhymes. Third one is slant rhymes, sometimes called imperfect, partial, near, oblique, off, etc. Slant rhymes. Fourth one is rich rhymes. Fifth one is I rhymes. Sixth is identical rhymes. These are certain important types of rhymes. How do you make a rhyme? The pattern of rhymes in a poem is written with the letters A, B, C, D, etc. The first set of lines that rhyme at the end are marked with A. The second set are marked with B. So, in a poem with the rhyme scheme A, B, A, B, the first line rhymes with the third line and the second line rhymes with the fourth line. This is about how do you make a rhyme in a poem. Students, please take a screenshot of this page. Types of rhyme scheme. What is ABAB rhymes called? Ballad, mono rhymes, the meaning of expression. Okay, from the heading. To cry wolf, to keep the wolf from the door, to wolf something down, to be a wolf in a sheep clothing. The meaning of these expressions are also given here. You can note it and learn. Okay, hard words there are also explained here. The three little pigs, the story is here. And also take a screenshot. You can take a screenshot. And if you are interested with such stories, you can read it more. Okay, these pages you have to take screenshot carefully and you have to read and understand it. Okay. Rhyme scheme meaning, what is rhyme scheme of the poem? What are the 6 type of rhymes? How do you make a rhyme? Okay students, your homework is read this poem at least 5 times in your home and underline the hard words and find out the meaning of the hard words with the help of a dictionary and come for the next class. Thank you for watching the video. See you in the next video.